The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Welcome, good night. Welcome to The Doctor Is In with me, Dr. Dinothra Archer Cartwright. I'm a family medicine specialist, so I do all things medicine from children to adults, for persons of all ages. And tonight's show is brought to you by Medical Concierge Services for all your medical healthcare needs. We also specialize in home care, so if you need a doctor or a nurse or any type of medical assistance at home, give us a call. We can help you out with that. We also have our clinic inside the Bahamas Heart Center. And if you're trying to reach us, you can reach us at 326-1521. Our WhatsApp line, WhatsApp only, 429-4880. You can find us on Facebook and Instagram, as well as our own website, which is mcsfamilymedicine.com. And you can check out all the interesting things that we do. So we do some alternative things as well, such as IV vitamins, microneedling. So you can go and check it out. So thank you for joining us. Like I say, again, for all things health, wellness, and things that pertain to the Bahamian society. We have a really interesting show tonight. This is an interesting topic that I kind of always kind of think about. It's one that touches everybody in some aspect, in some way. We all think about it in our lives at some point, you know, especially as we get older. And it's basically, we're going to talk about aging. And what makes us age? Why do we get older? Why can't we stay young forever? I mean, we all love the beauty, the aesthetics of youth, and it's something that we all crave in a sense. And so, I guess we think about it more as we get older, as things start to change, as our looks change, as our physicality change, as we encounter various illnesses and things that change our whole perspective on life. But aging has really is a part of life, and it's something that we all go through, but we go through it in various different ways, and not everybody kind of ages exactly the same. There's no set kind of number for each and every person, and it changes with ethnicity, with the countries, with just who you are, what you do. And we're going to look at all those kind of aspects of what causes us to age? What can we do something that's different? And, you know, what does that mean to us as individuals? And of course, we're going to give everybody a chance to jump into the conversation about aging, because, you know, we usually talk health and prevention, and all of that has an aspect of aging. But aging is very kind of specific to all of us. And, you know, when you think about your life cycle, you know, aging gets us from one stage to the next. But after we get to a certain point, you know, everybody wants to age less and less and less. And so I pride myself also on that as well. So I'm really into youth and staying young as much as possible, looking young, not just looking, but feeling in your actions. And that has a lot to do with a lot of different varying things. We're going to look at some of those things tonight. But just to kind of start us all off in terms of aging, let's look at some of the countries that have the people with the longest lifespan. And so you want to look a lot of times at these places and say, what are they doing? What? Why are the people there living for such a long time? And so some of the healthiest people in the world live in certain regions. And what the first article that I looked at in AccuWeather looks at maintaining youthful, radiant health as much as possible, and the cultures and the civilizations that do that, who live extraordinary long lives. And I like that word extraordinary, because it's been coming up in some other stuff that I've been reading, but to live an extraordinary life and to live an extraordinary long life is just called longevity. And so This is the first time in history when people are living such long periods of time. If you look back at your grandparents, your great-great-great-grandparents, there were some people that lived older into really old age, but there were a lot of people who died before they were in their 60s, and it was just known that a lot of people would not make it past 50, 55. And this is the first time in history where you have such a large amount of people that are healthier and living longer. And the number of people living past 60 is expected to double by 2050, and that is the WHO. The thing about living longer is it comes with another set of issues and another set of things to deal with. And so even as a doctor, we're dealing with a lot more of these diseases, problematic things, and even just great things, because people are living longer. What do they think has to do with it? Warm climates, people tend to live longer. So we're kind of blessed in Bahamas. We're in a very warm climate. We should live longer, but you're gonna see from some of the statistics I say, we're not quite where we should be as a country. And so warmer climates, they say, Stanford University research found that warmer climates over a period of time in the United States lowered mortality rates compared to the winter months when death rates peaked. Being close to the ocean also has health benefits and are related to some of the places where people lived longest. A study from the University of Exeter, European Center for Environment and Human Health, showed that people living near the coast tended to have a better overall health than people living inland. So we have all the sets up in the Bahamas to be living long, and we're going to see and compare, and we're going to talk about aging in itself. The Central Intelligence Agency, the CIA World Factbook, lists life expectancies at birth for more than 100 countries, which measures the overall quality of life in a country. Below are the five countries where people tend to live longer. So number one is a place called Monaco. Life expectancy there is 89.4 years. So these people on average live to almost the age of 90. That's a pretty long time. It's the second smallest country in the world. Monaco has the longest life expectancy on earth at 89.4 years. Their longer life expectancy could be attributed to factors including its state-funded healthcare system. So they have a really great healthcare system, as well as the they maintain a Mediterranean diet and a less stressful lifestyle. Coming after them is Japan, which has 127 million. So that country actually only had 38,000 people. Japan has over 127 million people, and the life expectancy there is 85.3. And Japanese people are able to live 75 of their years completely healthy and without disability. So these are very, very healthy places to be. Some factors that might contribute to this island nation, and island nation again, just like us, longevity, are healthy diets, physical activity, extended work years, according to AARP. So they work a lot longer, so they're keeping more active. And a study for the Center of Retirement Research at Boston College showed that they work past retirement years, and this could add to a person's life. And we hear about that sometimes. We hear about people, you know, when they finish their job and then things kind of go downhill versus kind of continuing to live. So someone's asked me online, good evening, Dr. Archer, where is the WHO getting or basing their statistics on? Well, the WHO does their own statistics, and I guess they get it from data from different countries, as well as they have their own informational sources. You have to realize that the WHO has groupings in all of these countries, so they do gather their own data, and then they get countries' data as well. And as you can see, even the CIA is keeping records of what's going on. Another small country, 33,000 people, 33,557, San Marino, life expectancy there is 83.3 years. And they live longer, mostly as well due to healthy lifestyle, Mediterranean diet, local grown foods, high employment rates, and low stress lifestyle. Iceland comes in at number five, 83.1. Some of these, if you look at different places, they're gonna be slightly different, but they have a very high fish diet, and they say there's a lot of good genetics there. And so those are, so where would the Bahamas be? So I moved over to another website looking at macro trends and the life expectancy. And I looked at the trend of the Bahamian life expectancy between 1950 to 1922. And what we saw is that we have had a significant improvement in life expectancy in the Bahamas. In 1950, the average age of life expectancy for a Bahamian was 62.39 years. And if we look at the projection or 2022, we see that life expectancy in the Bahamas has gone up to 74.17. So still pretty good, but nowhere near the close, the top as a lot of other countries. So if you were to check out this website, you'd see that we're way on the bottom. And the only two behind us would be Trinidad and Tobago and Seychelles. There are a lot of other countries, but we are not topping the list. We have quite a few countries, maybe about 30, 40, 50 countries that are kind of ahead of us in terms of life expectancy. And if we look at the United States, their life expectancy is about 79. So we are quite below them by about 5 years. So why is our life expectancy so low? And what can we do to change that is a question. But let's kind of look at aging as a whole. And so we're going to look at another article about why do we get old. And so aging really is the physiological changes we experience during our lifespan. And it's just inevitable. We're all going to age at, you know, throughout. That's how our human development is. And it's because our cells of our body don't last forever. And structures and functions in our body just decline over time. So comment online, it says, and it's true that people who live longer lives are the ones who eat more natural and organic foods and live in rural areas, correct. And they also mentioned living by the ocean, eating healthy foods, eating very naturally grown foods. Those were some of the conditions with some of those countries. As we mentioned, a lot of those countries are actually very small countries, 30, 40,000 people. But then you have places like Japan where, you know, the entire place, they're into healthy eating with over 127 million people. All right. But why? Why do we age? And people have been studying this for hundreds of years. There are more than 300 theories about this. There's so much study that's done. You know, we don't have all of it, but we have a lot of good ideas of why it happens. And when you look at why things happen, you can then look at how do you then tackle that, right? So there are types of aging. We have what we call intrinsic aging and extrinsic aging. And so the intrinsic aging is really what genetically predisposes us to aging. So it's the process of aging itself. It's internal. There's not usually a lot we can do with that. There is some aging that's going to occur. And then you'll see, as we talk about it a little more, there's some genetic component. And so the extrinsic aging is a result of outside factors, things that we choose to do, things that are in our environment, our stress levels, our lifestyle, things like smoking and what we put into our body. So as you can see, there's two different things that are going on. What's happening inside of us in terms of genetically and what we're predisposed to do, and then what affects us from the outside. And that has a lot to do with environment and what we do to ourselves. So when we look at cellular aging due to intrinsic factors, we look at more of a biological sense of aging and the biological change within ourselves. And these cells are basically the building blocks of our body. So our body is made up of all these little cells. They all have different functions. They all do different things. And as we get older, they eventually lose some of their ability. They lose some of their function. And they just get damaged over time because they're constantly changing over, and eventually our cells get old. So right down to the very smallest, tiniest level, we are aging. And these cells just become less healthy. The processes, the biological processes they're in charge of start to fail, and cellular damage accumulates over time. So damage related and environmental aging. So talked about internal, our cells constantly working, changing, you know, going over and over again, and eventually they just get really old and worn out. But there's also this external or extrinsic factors, or what we call environmental aging. And the damage related to this has to do with the surroundings, has to do with our lifestyles. And they include factors like air pollution. So if you're living in a place where there's a lot of pollution, a lot of smog, you can't breathe in really good air, that can be a factor in terms of how you age. Tobacco smoke. So if you are a smoker, you are already at risk of increasing the aging process within your body. So that is really a big one. If you're a smoker, you need to stop smoking. So alcohol consumption. So we don't really think about all the effects of alcohol, and it's not just alcoholism. With alcohol, you also can increase cellular aging. Malnutrition. So if you're not eating properly, and you'll see that, you know, not just being smaller, if you're too small, if you're not eating properly, if you are having malnutrition for some reason where you're not getting the proper nutrients into your body, you can also accelerate that cellular aging that's going on. And then ultraviolet rays, if you're in the sun for a very long time, especially people with fair skin, they can have quite a bit of aging. And all skin types, really, we should all protect ourselves. The sun, if it's constant, can be very damaging. As you all know, it's been extremely hot these last few days. I'm always just trying to stay in the AC as much as possible. But, you know, it's hot out there. And so if you're working outside, if you're doing all those types of things, sun can really be damaging. And it's even more so seen in our people with fair skin. So that melanin does protect you a bit, but you don't want to take advantage of it. You want to also protect your skin, people of color. So over time, all of these factors can lead to damage and contribute to the aging process. So everyone experiences both types of aging. However, each form of aging varies from person to person. So it's very different. We all experience aging differently, which explains the difference between all of us. So there are these various theories that are related to aging. We're going to go through some of them. There are a lot of them, but we're going to go through a few of them so that you have an understanding. And then we're going to talk about some of the other things that cause, and what can we do to kind of even cut down on this aging process. So there are different theories. One of the most prominent one is considered the program theories of aging. And this is where people are just basically designed to age, and that it's predetermined. And so this one is kind of one of the first ones to come out, and people just thought, hey, your genes, your endocrine system, your immunology, so your immune system, these things are all connected to your genetics, and they feel that that's where just aging is. So those persons who believe in program theory believe it's just predetermined, and that these genes get turned off and on over time, and you just age out. And the endocrine part of that theory, according to this theory, aging is caused by hormones, and which are produced by the endocrine system. You're going to see a little bit that we're going to talk about that later, why women don't age as fast as men in a lot of circumstances, and it has a lot to do with that. Immunological theory, which is basically that the immune response is designed to decline, and this results in a decreased aging. So your immune system goes down and you age a lot more. All right, so that has some support for that particular theory. But of course, that they suggest that habits like longevity, quitting smoking, exercises are useless. But we know that's absolutely not true, because we have a lot of studies that talk about the environmental aspects. There are some error theories of aging, where we talk about wear and tear. And this idea is that the cells break down and become damaged over time. But a lot of people realize that there is some cellular repair, so you can repair yourself, especially when you're younger. If you look at healing young children and babies and even young adults, that works really, really well. So we know that you don't get completely just worn out by just, you know, not being able to do any repair, but that repair seems to slow down over time. We have another comment from online. In my personal opinion, I believe modern science has it wrong and that they are helping people eat themselves into an early grave. Well, I'll just address that before we move on. I think it's a mixture of things. So we are living longer because we have access to better healthcare, access to more food. You have to understand that in those days, even though they may have lived, let's say, organically or off the land, there was a high stress environment. There wasn't great medical care. And so, yes, we have advanced. Now, what's happening right now is that we have advanced so far. And now I think there are some things that are turning things around in terms of the types of foods we're eating and those types of things. So even though we have made so much progress, in itself, some of the progress may be causing other problems, but we do live longer. For example, people in those days didn't have a lot of food. They may have not been able to have a variety of fruits and vegetables. They had to eat the things that were around them. And so those things maybe have led to malnutrition and other problems. So I think nutritional value has improved, but in some ways I do agree with you because the quality of certain things have also gone down as we continue to use technology and different ways of harvesting food. And there needs to be some type of balance, but we have made improvements on there. Dr. D, what do you think about fasting? I actually did a show fasting. And I think it's a good thing. I think it resets the body a lot of times. I think we do have a lot of access to food. So what we do is we do have people living longer, but we have to think about the quality of life. So if you're 75 years old and you have multiple comorbidities and you're on multiple medications, yes, you are alive, but what kind of life are you living? So I think fasting is good. Because not only in a spiritual way, but also because it gives your body a time to rid itself of free radicals, to just kind of gently cleanse your intestines. A lot of great things happen with fasting. It brings your sugar levels down. So, but if you're diabetic already, you should discuss fasting with your doctor. But fasting is good. You should take some time, and we don't always have to be eating and working our system and putting so much into our bodies. And people probably didn't eat as much of as we did as well. And so I think fasting is really, really good. I think it's good for your mind as well. So I agree with fasting if done properly. Okay, thank you for that question. So we're going to talk a little bit more about some of these and see that some of these theories are talking about some of the things that was made in the comment, because there are theories about free radicals and oxidative stress. And you've heard me talk about things like that before. And that's why I do a lot of personally glutathione and foods that contain glutathione, as well as glutathione IV. You've heard me talk about that before, because I do believe in the oxidative stress does cause aging. And therefore, if we can reduce that, vitamin C, glutathione, those types of things really get that down. A lot of other theories related to the way that the cells work, including cross-linkage, mitochondrial theory, which had free radicals in the body, and damage caused to the mitochondria over time. And if you know the mitochondria, it's a part of the cell that really is like the powerhouse. And so they feel like as that starts to wear and tear, you start to get aging. There are genetic theories of aging, which looks at particular types of cellular interaction, will it be telomere theory, program sentence theory, stem cell theory. And if you know anything about stem cells, these are the cells that can really turn into any other cells, and they help for tissue and organ repair. But after a while, they decline in our bodies. They're not able to do what they could before, and this could be related. And there is a longevity theory, gene theory, that is certain genes extend their lifespan, and more research is needed on that. If you always listen to me, and you know, I'm a very spiritual person. So God promised you at 70, that's 70. Anything over that is a blessing. So we're moving in the right direction. But as a country, we're a little bit lower down on the scale. And so we have countries that are people who are living up to 89% as an average, 89 years and above as an average. Okay, but there are limitations to some of these genetic theories. They disregard the importance of the external factors. And it's estimated that only 25% of our lifespan is influenced by genetics. So only 25% of your life expectancy is based on your genetics. So you can't really say that, you know, oh, it's my, we hear people all the time, it's my family's a certain way. Yes, it does have a contribution, but it's found that a lot of the reasons that affect your aging and your health is related to environmental or external factors. All right, we have another question, I believe, online. Infinity Stubbs, could stem cell therapy be used to reverse aging? Well, that is a big question, and that's why there's been a lot of research into stem cell therapy, because they feel like it can in some ways. I don't think they've done it like just like, ooh, give you stem cells and your complete person is revived, but they do use stem cells today in various areas where there may have been degeneration or some problems. So you'll see like athletes are using it when they have injuries, especially in areas where they're not healing very well. And so stem cells are being used in some places to help with aging, and specifically for certain injuries and different things where they want to have growth where they may not have had it before, because those cells are able to turn into other cells, cells that may already be on a decline. There is evolutionary theory of aging, which looks at mutations and you know, different things, presuming that this is random mutations that accumulate over time, because you're always copying yourself, you're always copying your DNA. And so after a while, that just kind of wears out, right? There are biochemical theories of aging. You know, there's so many. So why do our life expectancies increase, right? We touched on this in the very beginning, but in recent decades, life expectancy around the world has increased, and this is due to what we mentioned before: better nutrition, improved hygiene, access to healthcare, and improvements in modern medicine. A lot of the things that would have killed you 50, 60, 100 years ago, we have treatments for. Infectious diseases, STDs, you know, just common colds and flus over time, we've become more resilient to them. You know, if you get certain infections, you know, even it's treatable these days. So if you look at modern medicine, we are able to treat a lot of things that we weren't able to before. You know, a lot of people silently died from cancers. We're able to both screen for a lot of these cancers and provide some treatment for quite a few of them. We have surgical options. We have so many different things. So there are improvement in those things have really helped over time. And access to better nutrition is one of those things, because even though people lived off the land, they were very limited in their scope of food. So we have it a lot better. What we do with it, that is the question, right? At this point, we're almost at the pinnacle where we're now producing so much food that we're kind of mass producing in a way that there are some negatives to processed foods and those types of things, but they're bringing on maybe a different set of issues that we had before. And this is how we end up with people who are living longer, but maybe not always with the best quality of life. So we have people who are 60, 70, 80, 90 years old. They've been able to survive a stroke. They've been able to survive all of these things. So quality of life really plays a really big role, because you don't just want a long life. You want a life where you are not fragile, where you're not sick and laying in bed. You want a life where you're able to live and do things without, you know, being dependent on other people. So that's really, really important. And that's a concept that I actually did a paper on a long time ago on fragility. I did a presentation as well on that. So fragility, it's a totally different concept, but it's the whole idea of retaining not just long life, but health. I mentioned this earlier on, and we'll do this before we go to a bit of a break and open the line. Why do women live longer than men? So women do tend to live longer. And if you look at all the tables of life, you will see that women tend to have a couple additional years on men. But why does that happen? Why do women live longer than men? You know, there's various different reasons, but one of the main ones is our women and their hormones. So those same hormones that we talk about all the time that cause all the different things that cause your period cycles and all of these things, they're also really what gives women the advantage on longer life. Mainly, that hormone that's very helpful for women is called estrogen. You should have heard about estrogen before. I hope you've heard about it, but it is one of the main female sex hormones. And estrogen has anti-inflammatory properties, and it is immune boosting, and it just protects women from certain diseases. But for a large chunk of a woman's life, she is way more protected than a lot of types of diseases, more than a man. And so by having this effect, women tend to have a longer longevity in life. And the male sex hormone, which would be testosterone, however, sadly suppresses the immune system. And so men typically have this hormone more often than women, and their lifespan tends to be a bit shorter. There are other differences that women have that men don't have, which is women tend to, and these are more external factors, that was the internal factor, the hormonal difference. But women eat healthier. Women tend not to eat a lot healthier than men. Women tend to think of their health more often. We tend to see that women drive more safely, so they're less likely to. I know some men might disagree with this, but that is what they're saying, that women do drive a lot more safely. And that might mean maybe taking a lot less chances to do certain things. Although I think, you know, small car drivers seem to be the most dangerous. I'm sorry, small car drivers, but on the road, you guys seem to be the most dangerous, whether you're women or men. Women consume less alcohol, less tobacco, and less drugs. So women tend to consume less of these things that are not going to be helpful for them. And a comment online says, that's not what the Bible says. Methuselah was the oldest man in the world. Well, possibly so. I think with Bible stuff, I think context is really important. I'm not sure how they calculated years and ages and stuff like that in those days, but that is something to think about. And the Bible also talks a bit in like parables and different things as well. So we're kind of talking about the last few hundred years of our existence and what we've kind of had the data for. So it would be very difficult to compare to maybe what happened thousands of years ago. But as far as we know ourselves, as far as we've been taking record of these things, these are the statistics. And women are more likely to access healthcare services. So if a woman is sick, a woman's not feeling well, she is more likely than a man to go and seek help. And hence that also expands a woman's longevity. So can we slow the aging process? Can we slow it? And aging is definitely inevitable, but there are possible ways to slow down the process. And of course, the number one, before we get to that, open up the lines. So if you want to jump in the conversation, if you have a question and you're listening tonight on air, the number is 322-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259, 322-6232, 325-4316, and 325-4259. So what do we do? How do we maximize our ability to limit aging as much as possible? If only 25% of our genetics is making up the reason or the way that we age, that means we have 75% to work with. So eating nutritious foods, foods focused on our fruits, our vegetables, our whole grains, and our lean proteins. on reducing the, I know this is getting harder and harder and harder to do, but limiting processed food, and that includes fast food. So when we go to the store, and I'm noticing this, so much of our food is now packaged, packaged, packaged. We need to spend more time in the produce section, less time in the packaging section. And we need to, that means you have to cook more because the more of your food is coming fresh. We need to get back to our gardens. And so we're getting more nutritious foods. And so nutritious, healthy food is gonna be the number one thing. Staying active, we always talk about exercising. It's just quickly and mentally. I'm realizing that a lot of people in this country at an older age, even if they're weren't super unhealthy or super having multiple comorbidities, but a lot of people are getting Alzheimer's disease. So mental health and clarity is also extremely, extremely important. So physical activity is really, really gonna be important with that. Avoiding tobacco. So if you are a smoker of any sort, smoking is just really, really bad. If you look at almost any disease out there, smoking is a risk factor. So you wanna avoid smoking, you wanna avoid tobacco. So you wanna stop, you wanna quit. And so you can get help from your doctor or you can get counseling, but make up your mind today that you're going to stop smoking, all right? And you can have a plan, we call it, you can have a plan to get smoking out of your life. Drinking alcohol in moderation. So alcohol increases your risk of chronic diseases. Any chronic disease is gonna limit you, it's gonna make you age faster, is going to put more oxidative stress on your body, inflammation. So you want to limit things that are going to lead you down the road of chronic disease. So you want to be really moderate or not drink at all. And so you do this by, you know, following kind of like guidelines of how much alcohol you should definitely use. And yes, yes, online, agree. Physical activity is definitely a yes. Knowing your family history. Now, this is a really big one because this one allows you to kind of be screened appropriately when you go to see your doctor. Knowing your family history, a lot of people don't know their medical family history, which is a big question that we ask initially for the first time. We want to know what's going on because it gives you an idea of how to look into the genetic output in your life. So we look at your mother, your father, your grandparents, your siblings, close aunts and uncle, it all helps to tell a story of genetically what may be going on inside of you without doing a genetic test. And so knowing your family history is important. Sit down, talk to your mother, talk to your father. Some people aren't as close with their father's family, but you still have those genes. And so it's really important to have both sides of what's going on genetically in your body. And that way you can get early treatment and early screening for diseases and potential chronic diseases. I have people who come in and they're like, oh, I'm healthy, I exercise, I do this, but they're hypertensive. And why is that? That genetic component. Their parents, their, you know, their mother, their father, family history of hypertension, maybe even heart disease. And so that person we would put on a slightly different program because they may not be the typical person that you expect to have hypertension or one of these chronic illnesses, but because of their genetics, they have to work a lot harder. Okay, comment online. Dr. D, I also believe that those who are less physically and do less physical activity are more prone to COVID. Yes, because if you looked in the beginning, one of greatest factors for COVID, we always kind of get back to COVID, obesity. So if you're living a very sedentary lifestyle, then yes, you will have higher risk of getting COVID and, you know, having to deal with some of the issues with COVID. So health was a really big part of how I looked and I risk stratified my patients in terms of who would be more risky than others. And so that's why from day we should be working on our health and our immune system rather than some of this other stuff, okay? And so we talked about knowing your family history, attending regular checkups. So, and remember with men, we realized that they lived a little bit less because they were less inclined to go to the doctor. Don't be afraid of going to the doctor. Find a doctor that you are comfortable with, who understands you, who will listen to you, who will answer your questions, and you go from there. Because if you can have a good relationship with your doctor, you're not going to be afraid, and then you're going to go in more easily if you do have a problem. So getting your regular checkups for healthy adults is just once a year. Go get your annuals, and then you can help to prevent some early disease issues. Engaging your brain. So you want to protect your cognitive brain exercises. So doing activities that are going to keep your mind going, reading, doing games, other activities are really good, just because, like I talked about, mental health is important and cognition is important. So you want to be able to think, understand, and have a good memory as you get older. Because Alzheimer's and dementia on the whole can be very stressful for both the patient and their family. And I do see a lot of patients with dementia, especially when I do a lot of phone call work where people are kind of stuck in bed or they have dementia. So lots of Bahamians out there suffering from dementia. Sunscreen, it's something that we don't think about. And for a big chunk of my life, I didn't wear sunscreen. You know, we all think the melanin is going to protect. But over time, especially as we get older, it can be really good. So you want to find that, you know, it's not really heavily chemically based and that can give you the type of coverage. It is getting hot. It is very sunny out there and you just want to avoid being in that direct sunlight as much as possible. If you won't have to be out there, maybe wear a hat. If you like to go to the beach and do activities, you want to do that early in the morning or late in the afternoon when the sun's going down. But that direct heat is something else. So what do we take away from all of that? Aging basically happens for a combination of reasons. A combination of things cause it. It's various different theories. We didn't even go through all of them because there's so many, there's so much research that's been done in this area. And all of these things, from what is predetermined in our genetics, to what we do every day of our life, all play a role in the aging process. Genetics, evolution, biology, environment. So it's normal, but with a healthy lifestyle, you can live longer, so you wanna eat well, exercise, wear your sunscreen, and improve your quality of life. Comment online, that may be a weird question, but why don't more doctors talk about our spiritual side? Well, it is because, you know, that we're medically trained, but when you get into end of life concepts, you know, there is a spiritual component to it all. And not just Christianity, because Christianity is our basis of spirituality. Other people have other bases of their spirituality, but being connected to a higher power is actually linked to people doing a lot better in certain circumstances like cancer treatment. If you believe that you can be healed, if you believe that, you know, there's more to life there, that gives you something to hold on to, they tend to do a lot better, especially with kind of some of these chronic disease issues and things like cancer. So there is definitely a role for spirituality in healing. In the practice of medicine, I think that helps to give me a bit of intuition because I do believe in a higher power. I do believe in modern medicine as well. And I believe that God gave man the insight and the ability to do some things for himself. And that is the power of healing and that is the power of medicine. So I do not hold them as a separate thing. Some people may be more vocal and some people may not be spiritual. That would be hard to just kind of base things just in spirituality because when you are a doctor, you have to deal with everybody and people have varying beliefs. I have my personal beliefs and that becomes a part of the way that I practice because I do believe in there being more. And I do believe that there's a possibility for healing and really good outcomes that are beyond even me. So that's the way that I kind of tackle spirituality. Everybody's going to do that in a different way. And some people, don't forget, are not spiritual. You're going to have doctors who are spiritual. You're going to have doctors who are atheists. You're going to have doctors who believe in different things. And the same thing with patients. But if we all come on one accord, because if you know anything about life, when if you follow the rules of life, it doesn't really, really matter that much, because on a positive accord to do something and we truly believe in what we're doing, you tend to have better outcomes. So I hope that kind of answers this whole thing about spirituality. I can only give it to you from my context. And that's how I feel about spirituality and healing. I definitely feel there's a role. I definitely believe in higher power. I am personally a Christian, but I know everybody has different beliefs. So 322-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. How do you think you're aging? Are you aging appropriately? Do you think it's just your genetics? Or what do you think? Before we go, we're going to talk a little bit about chronological aging and biological aging. And so when we talk about chronological aging, we're just talking about your age from birth until now. So, you know, if you've been on this planet, you are 21. But every 21-year-old does not look the same age. Every 30-year-old does not look the same age. Every 40-year-old does not look the same age. I've had someone, two people come in, they're both 60 years old. One is a vibrant, young 60, energetic, doing lots of things. Another one may be bedridden or suffering from multiple comorbidities or various other issues. And so biological age and chronological age can be different. So chronologically, we can both be 21, but biologically, how our bodies are functioning can be aged in a different way. Caller, you're on the air.
Good evening, Dr. Archer. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, I'm all right. The best show in town, eh? That's what
thank
I call
you,
it. But I was enjoying the whole show. And so, you know, just to chime in and augment, you know, the thing is, as you spoke, I went on Henrietta Lacks, right? And so I didn't know she was born on August the 1st because I born on August the 8th. And so she's a Leo, so she's a lioness, right? And so, you know,
yeah,
she's
like
a
my
lady.
Grandmother, who is 98 years old, born August 1st.
She blessed.
Yep.
You know, but, you know, but listen, I wanted to get into this information on Henrietta Lacks and you know, that she's known as the immortal cells, right? The immortal, which they use her cells.
They used her cell line, right?
Yeah, and they call her the healer, but they should have called her the Sheila, because and then I listened to you saying women generally live long or age slower than men. Mm-hmm. And it could be so because they say once they fed the cells and keep them in a culture, they grew. They were cancerous. I guess they probably took it from a cervix because they said she had cervical cancer. But in looking at all of this construct, as far as man wanting to stay young, and it leads into transhumanism. And then we're looking at, RNA interference technology occurs naturally in eukaryotic cells. But as far as using it for the food industry, they have been provided data basically as to what this means, even as far as the cannabis plant, what most people don't understand, because I've been reading High Times before their times. I have High Times, copies of High Time magazine, like 30-something years old. And what I remembered was, when you grow the plant unnaturally, you expose the plant to 24-hour light to hasten the growth, which is because it's a financial construct. So you want to hasten. They would hasten them because they would separate males from females. So they would put them under 24-hour light, 18-hour light, and then 14-hour light, and they would reduce the time. But what I learned and what I remembered was that when you expose the plant to 24-hour sunlight and 18-hour sunlight, the plant becomes stressful, and it produces something they call they produce trichomes, and that's like the hairy, like you know, like projections on the plant, and so it actually is a sign of stress. So what I'm saying is, not only specifically to the marijuana plant, but all the RNA interference technology that man has done, because RNA interference technology occurs naturally with higher plants and some insects, and with viruses as a form of mutation and just being able to counteract against infections, etc. Right. So I was looking at all that. They haven't done any data to show what is. So we know that the cells have, I can't remember the terminology, but they have like a certain amount of time that they have to reproduce. So this is why Henry Lotta's cells were so important, because they actually kept reproducing. All right, there's a certain amount of time that the cells can reproduce, and then they have to just die out. And so they find in a way, I can't remember, I saw it, but I can't remember, there's a way for them to rejuvenate this process, in a sense. And then I look at the rejuvenation of the cell line. Somebody just walked in my store and disturbed me. I even broke my chain of thought, to be honest with you. But Dr. D.
Yes.
In all honesty, what I'm saying is, with trying to live forever, people will try that and they will brainwash you. But what I wanted to get in, I remember, as far as metabolic syndrome, that is all external environmental factors, and mm-hmm. which you get all that deals with oxidative stress and what you call metabolic syndrome.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. All right.
Yeah, thank you. We touched a little bit on some of those things he talked about with oxidative stress. And that's why I do a lot of IV vitamin C, glutathione, and those types of things, because they really are really good for those things. And so there are ways beyond just like, we're looking at all kinds of ways of keeping young, right? So I'm going to be doing a lot of stuff, even looking at Botox and different things like that. So people are into aesthetics. So that component of it, you know, I don't mind getting into as well. But then, of course, internally, you have to do a lot of work in the healthy eating department and all of that stuff. So if you look at the rich and the wealthy, they're kind of tapping into different aspects of all of those things, trying to live as long as they can, kind of chasing that youth. You don't want to go too crazy with all of that stuff, but a little bit here and a little bit there as well is probably going to be your best way to go. Completely. And so you can be a very healthy, young looking 60, 70 year old. And it really a lot has to do with the things that we talked about and how you treated your body over the years and what you put in it. So these things are extremely important. And that's why preventative healthcare. So I'm a preventivist in a sense. Prevention is better than cure, because if you can limit a lot of these diseases now in your life, you have a lot of space in the future, and you want to look young and you want to look beautiful forever. You want to have good skin. You want to have all of these things. These are important, because you don't want to have all this life and not be able to live it as abundantly as you can and to be able to do those things. So I always look at that comparison. You can have two people the very same age and they are not the same. And that's the whole concept of chronological age and biological age. So biologically, you can be younger than you are. We've seen people who are in their 60s and 70s, and we say, boy, they look 40, they're very active, or they're doing all these things. So aging doesn't have to be a really bad process. It can be something that's really, really amazing, but you have to take really good care of yourself. So be able to tell you have the physical condition of a 21-year-old, and this would be considered your biological age. So if your body is doing a lot better than your actual age, then, you know, you will have a better opportunity to live a longer and better life. And so your chronological age is just your age in years. And your biological aging is basically the aging that you gradually accumulate due to the various damage. So you want to limit that as much as possible. You want to be able to limit the damage you do to your body, because there is that genetic component that is kind of cause you to live a certain way. Sorry about that. So your actual number comes down to different biological and physical factors, and these include your chronological age, your genetics, your lifestyle, your nutrition, and diseases and other conditions. So by using these guidelines as well, we can even look at mathematical equations that will give you kind of figure out the age of your actual body and your actual cells. So those two things don't have to match. You can do things to kind of live and be younger than you actually are. And so how to age healthy, you want to take numerous steps to improve your biological age, and you want to start at whatever age you are now. So if you are not doing what you think that you need to do to live a healthy life because you want to be healthy at 60 plus, you are going to have to engage in some of the things we talked about. And we'll just kind of pull it all together. So exercise. But specifically, there are various exercises that you can use that are going to help. And especially help with those who already may have high blood pressure and arthritis can improve from regular exercises. And what type of exercise specifically? You want to look at balancing exercises because you want to reduce your risk of falls and any major cause of injury that can happen to you as an older person. So if you start working on your balance and your balance exercises now, that will give you some core that will help you when you're older, when you may be a little bit more fragile. So you want to work on that. Strengthening exercises, that helps to build the muscle mass, which reduces things like osteoporosis later in life. And also really great for people who have arthritis. So, you know, sometimes we'll tell you which exercises to do if you have osteoarthritis. So we want to reduce your risk of falling, because if you fall, that reduces, increases your risk of end up getting bedridden and other things and stuff like that. So all with the concept of frailty or fragility that I've spoken about. Endurance exercises. So that helps your breathing, that helps with your heart rate. It improves your lung health and your stamina. So it's also really, really good for your circulatory system. And, you know, some people even get bedridden because of circulatory issues. And so that is really where it's going to help. I realize I didn't take a break, but we're almost done. So that's your endurance training. And that can be exercises like swimming, walking, or biking. Those are all really good endurance exercises. Stretching. So keeping your body loose allows you to continue to do your everyday tasks and with minimal aches and pain. So if you're a lot less achy, you're able to do your task of daily living, as we call them, then you're going to be a much healthier biologically and compared to your chronological age. And you want to maintain a healthy weight, so you don't want to put on too much weight. And if you look at body shapes, more fat in the abdomen area is going to be more risk for heart disease and other things. And you want to have more of that hourglass or that pear-shaped body is going to be a much healthier distribution of fat. There's so much more that we could talk about, but we're going to have to end the show tonight. So I want to thank everybody for listening in and, you know, try to age appropriately and do what you can. Come in and see your doctor. And we're open to see you too at Medical Concierge Services for all your medical health needs. I want to thank you tonight to spending your time with me, Dr. D. Archer, the doctor is in. And I'm just going to say good night and thank you for watching the show.